From Carolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, Ron Funches, with Gina Grad on news, Bald Brian on sound effects, and the spirited round of the Rotten Tomatoes game. And now, he's got a lot of unpopular opinions, but he's also got a lot of popular opinions. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get it on. The choice has been a mandate. You get it on. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Handball, Brian.
The fuck?
All right. Well, Max Pound, my little screen here isn't working, but I'm not sure what the cause of that is. But anyway. So I, over the weekend, went to Ozzie's funeral.
Oh.
I sat next to Ray and Chris. Couple things about the mask and wearing a suit to a funeral. I sat down at the end. I was sitting next to Ray, and after about 10 minutes, I went, where's Chris? And he went, he's sitting right next to us.
No.
But the mask, especially the big-time mask,
yeah,
mixed with the suit, could not figure it out.
Were there sunglasses involved? Because that can really mess things
up.
Yeah,
you're very secret service.
He wasn't wearing them, but I was wearing three pair because
right.
I didn't want to
okay.
be recognized.
That's fair.
I was like that preacher. He doesn't know the bass drum from a pipe organ.
Two-part sunglasses.
That guy, yeah.
Hey, two thoughts about Dawson's intro. First of all, fantastic. Secondly, the remix, there was some talk before about remixes that made you think, like, the 80s song where it's just more crap. Do, 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 do. It's
right.
not like musicianship. It's just do, do,
right.
do. An extra round of do,
right.
do, do,
right.
do.
It's like somebody said, this soup isn't thick enough, and someone went, well, just dump flour into it.
Yeah. Like, make it a roux.
All right, but that's not making it better.
Right.
Yeah, but you said you wanted
it
thicker.
Yeah.
There's more.
Right.
There's more.
What's the problem?
Yeah, I know. The remix, like the extended dance version remix, which is just one looped syntho part from the song. You're not adding anything to the song.
You're right.
Lengthening the song.
And these days they would yell, soup, because they go, remix, for no reason.
Oh, really?
Yeah. They yell that at the beginning of every remix.
I don't know why, but Sonny's now old enough to laugh his ass off when we were watching some movie. I can't remember what it was a few days ago, but something was done to somebody, and I was explaining
Sounds
to him.
Sounds hilarious.
Yeah, I said to him, oh, when I was young, in my room, I had one of those patent fans, those kind of industrial ones that were like on the floor with the weird bent metals on high, and they threw an entire sack of gold metal flour into the fan, and you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And Sonny was laughing his ass off. He was like, God, I can't believe your friends would do that.
It's a good
time. Yeah, in a few years, we'll get into the real stuff. They did. That was considered...
The hate crimes.
Yeah, the sack of flour in the fan was considered bullet dodge.
That's
adorable.
Yeah. That's what they did when they were storing up, you know, when they're working
brewing.
Their bowels up and brewing and getting to the real stuff.
So how was the funeral? What was that like?
Well, the funeral was interesting. It was at Hollywood Forever.
Wow.
And they have wild peacocks running all about
the
place.
They're showing a movie.
Yeah, and the
mean geese there too.
The peacocks just let these screams out for no good reason, and
it must be mating season.
You could all hang your head for a moment of silence and prayer, and then you'd hear this peacock just wah, wah, and it's like it kind of
actually has that
drop,
freaks you out a little bit.
It's, shut up.
Yes. At some point, three peacocks started heading into the tent we were all in and had to be shooed away by an usher. Like they were just, they were just heading in. You know, I've talked about the marriage with the rabbi and the priest.
Mm-hmm.
Never really considered the bilingual funeral.
Oh, twice as long.
Everything was done in English and then in Spanish.
Yep.
And oftentimes the same person
Ozzie
would just
spoke
do the beginning. I know. And then they would do the rest.
Yep.
And then they'd come back to the English again. So it took a little while. Had one of the most insane horn honks ever, which is after the funeral was pretty long. It was about an hour and a half, maybe two hours. After that, It's also kind of a weird thing. The pallbearers, you know, they just kind of walk around to the crowd and go, hey, you look fit. You know, you want to hop
yes,
up there? And
it's like,
did they really?
Yeah, it kind of seems like the kind of thing they should work out in advance, you know, because guys could have bad backs or feel weird.
I was asked to be a pallbearer on the day of my aunt's funeral, and I was post like cancer treatment. I was like, can I be on the right side? Because this is going to go badly if I'm not.
This was 10 minutes before the casket. Open casket, which I've not been to in a while. That's good and weird. So the thing about the open casket is everyone goes, oh, it's weird. And then they go, you got to go. You got to go up there. And then you go, I thought we established this was weird and haunting. And they're like, yeah, but go anyway.
Yeah.
So there was that. Now, the horn honk. So this place is... Hollywood Forever Funeral Home is kind of like the Madonna Inn, bringing all roads lead to Madonna. It's just kind of funky and weird.
Love
there's just
the
like
Madonna Inn.
There's headstones everywhere, and I can't, you know,
but there's no HOA in the Hollywood Forever Cemetery.
I study commercials. Yeah. Boy, do I study headstones. Like I walk by, you see that couple, and it's like, God, she outlived him by 37 years. Yeah. You know, he died in 79. Yeah. She died in 2018. Holy shit. Yeah. You know, like all that stuff.
There's a lot of face etchings at
Lots of face etchings and just flat out photographs that have been grafted onto the headstone, which is, I don't know. I'm a little older school with the
high-tech stuff.
Yeah, yeah, it's a little weird. Yeah. It's kind of like the birthday cakes that are airbrushed. Yeah. I'm going to see an exact likeness of the kid as I drag the knife through his neck.
Yeah,
that feels weird.
Just give me a clown.
Right. So, but the horn honk. So after I got to kind of break down on Ozzie. Ozzie worked with Chris, my buddy doing earthquake rehab in like 86. He then got pawned off to Ray, who did earthquake rehab 3 years later.
It's a terrible eulogy.
And then at some point, he got pawned off to me. And then luckily, I made it in show business, so I never had to cut him loose.
Right.
But if I was making $15 an hour, I may have had to make some business decisions.
Correct.
So Ozzie hung out, flapsteak and chimichurri and all that. But anyway, the horn honk. So the woman who's kind of been putting the whole thing together is just an angel's named Sharon. And I met Sharon when we did the Hammer, and she met Ozzie when we were doing the Hammer. And as soon as the Hammer, she loved Ozzie. And then as soon as the Hammer ended filming, she had Ozzie doing work at her house and became like, I don't know, the son she never had. And they became very close. And so at the end of the funeral, we're standing by my car. This was Ray and Chris. And, you know, we go back 40 years plus. And we hadn't seen each other in a while. So it's like three guys standing in a suit. And we're all kind of commiserating and talking about Ozzie and that kind of stuff. And at some point, Sharon and her girlfriend, the angels who were working when Ozzie was in the hospital and trying to get him the best care and everything, they just stopped their car next to our car in the back where the funeral, where all the roads are in the back there amongst the headstones and mausoleum and everything. And she just stopped, did that move for a second where she went like, thanks for coming out. I know Ozzie. And a honk on the horn behind her, standing in a fucking graveyard. Everyone's wearing a suit. She like stopped for a beat to say thanks for coming out. And the guy behind her, who was also just attending a funeral, possibly Ozzie's.
The fuck?
Just literally just honked.
That's
horrible. Just laid on the horn while we were just standing by the hood, leaning in, going, thanks for coming out.
That's crazy.
Ray didn't piss on his car?
It's crazy. And then...
should be so lucky.
Right.
And then looked for a place to park right next to us. As like, who are these people
like
that are
quail.
So unaware... of their environment.
The
it's
fuck?
It's insane. We're at a mortuary. We're standing. Everyone's wearing a suit. Yeah. We've just attended a funeral, and the person who's talking to us presumably just attended the funeral too and is either saying thanks for coming, shedding tears, or saying we'll see you at Arts Deli.
Right.
It's in Studio City. Laid right into the horn.
That's your head to toe in black. You're bereaved. You're
just standing there.
Jesus.
Her car didn't come to a complete stop before the guy was on the horn.
What
Who
a
is
major
that person?
Was pretty
douche.
Wild.
That is major douchery, right?
That's crazy.
He had us out of the movie that night.
Yeah. So anyway, that was that was interesting.
But and Ray, really, there was no confrontation, August style?
No, we're all too old. We just stood there and just looked at the person like they're insane and then watched as they tried to find a place to park 20 feet from where we're all still standing. All big dudes, by the way. Just going to get out. Just going to park
it. It's reprehensible.
I completely agree. Also, we were outdoors. They have a tent out there, but still, because everyone's nuts, everyone's wearing a mask outdoors. Yeah. And then everyone delivers the eulogy with the full mask, which does not convey much of anything.
No.
Like, so much is in the face. And when it's pulled up just under the, you know, the bridge of the nose to pass the chin, you're not getting their emotions or their thoughts or their feelings.
And if they're a little shy or if they're a little older, you can't hear them. You can't interrupt them to say, "We can't hear you." It's very difficult.
I did that move, which was like, it's the perfect. I was sitting in the middle back and, you know, they're doing, if anyone has anything to say, and, you know, Ozzie's kids got up there and people were coming up and they were short and sweet, not as verbose as your people, Gina. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then at some point, people like looking at me like, come on, you got to say something. You got to say something. I was like, I just want to sit here. And then couple of people brought my name up. Like, we want to thank Adam because putting Ozzie in the movie, that was a big deal for him and blah, blah. Once my name got brought up a couple of times. So I was like, I was going to be the last person to go. So it's like
the closer.
So there was this pause and everyone's just kind of looking at me and I went like, okay. And I stood up and I took like three steps toward the podium. And of course, an elderly woman stood up right in front of me and started walking. I had to do the move where I walked backwards and pretended to sit down. I did a full moonwalk and sat down. It's like, oh, of course she had to stand up and say something. And I had to go, oh, yeah, no, it's good.
You like.
So there was that.
Oh, God. Did you say something?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I talked about, you know, I'll tell you what I said about Ozzie. Ozzie's a guy, you know, he always showed up. He was always in a great mood. Mm-hmm. He was making his cluck cluck sound for the kids all the time. He was happy. He was always gregarious, always laughing, always a kind of smile on his face and in a good mood. And I said, you know, that's who Ozzie was. But I said, it's not like Ozzie didn't have bad days or problems. That's what he chose to bring. So all of us who, when people go, how's it going? Oh, don't get me started. Yeah.
You don't want to know.
That's our mode. And the people who are constantly in a good mood, have a smile on their face, something nice to say, cheerful, well, we look at them sometimes as dullards who don't have problems. But take my word for it, Ozzie had problems. He just didn't burden you with his problems, which I thought that's the lesson we should learn from Ozzie. Because everyone talked about, whoa, he's such a great mood, and there's always just great energy, and always a kind thing to say, and blah, blah, always a smile on his face. And it's like, yeah, but he had arguably had more problems than I had, or many of the people whose face he was trying to put a smile on, but he didn't tell you about it.
Yeah.
He didn't burden you with it. He didn't get into it. All you knew is he was happy to see you. It was a good day.
Yes.
And that's what we should tear out of his playbook. That's the lesson.
What is modern millionario man?
That is right. So, God, and the open casket is weird because when you're so used to seeing people and they're so full of life and they're always doing a thing, you're just kind of waiting for them to pop up.
But I'm glad we don't do that, our people.
Yeah. Also, Ozzie's ex-wife, Sylvia, used to wear a lot of White Diamonds perfume.
Oh.
And
these have always brought me luck.
Yes, Liz Taylor. Yeah. And it was a lot. It was so much that if she ever cleaned my house, I'd open the front door and I knew. And but the house was 6,000 square feet. I opened the front door. I was like, oh, where's Sylvia? Because I can fucking smell her. Once I announced that to Jimmy, Jimmy bought her a chub pack size. He bought her a 7-liter bottle.
Sure.
He bought her a fucking growler of White Diamonds and then told her,
"You love it.
Adam loves this essence." So double down.
That's great.
And of course, she doubled down. Now, what she would do then is she would pick up Sonny and Natalia. Oh, I love them so much when they were two. And then at some point, I'd come home and the onesies were polluted with White Diamonds because she had it all over. all over her. But evidently, it's a familial thing because the entire tent smelled like white diamonds.
Wow.
This was her. This is her kin. This is her sister. The mom. Wow. And everyone is just
scent.
Doused in white diamonds. So it's not a pleasant fragrance for the ladies.
Even a dot of it is overpowering.
Yes.
So if you really shan't that's the kind where you spray and you leap through it like a gazelle and you keep walking. You don't spray it white diamonds directly on your body.
Well, she had a dunk tank with white diamonds in it, and that tent smelled like it harkened back to a simpler time. When I was in my house and she was cleaning it covered with white diamonds.
Sure.
All right. I also got a note from Nate that Bill Whittington died in a plane crash. And who's Bill Whittington? Bill Whittington is he's of the Whittington brothers.
Oh, with
the car.
Yes. These guys were the craziest, fastest, hardest driving
souped
nut
up.
Jobs. Ever. I mean, again, they show up at Le Mans in 1979. They've never driven at Le Mans. It's the biggest 24-hour race in the world. They are slated to drive with one professional driver who's driven the K3 Kramer 935 Porsche. The guy who runs the team explains to them they'll go after the professional driver, takes his stint out there for 2 hours, then come back in and they'll do tires and fuel, and then you'll jump out and the other guy will jump in. These guys are so nuts, they go, we're going first. And the guy owns the car is like, you're not going first. You've never even driven this car. And this guy's a professional German. He's campaigned this car all over Europe. And then it's like, what if he gets in a crash? What if the car breaks? Like, well, then that's racing, and that's it.
Yeah.
The car's out. You're out. You don't race. And they're like, fuck that. How much for the car? It's the craziest, ballsiest move
that's
ever.
Great.
And then the guy throws out a price that's nuts for back, 1979. Right. It's like $250,000. Like, all right,
done.
Go to the trailer, get a duffel bag of cash, throw it at the guy, and go, now we go first.
That's F me money.
Then they win the race outright.
That's badass.
Last production car, not GTP, not supercar, not prototype, last production car of any car based on a 911. The 935
right.
is a kind of production car. It's the last one to ever win that race.
That's
outright.
Insane.
They win it outright.
So that because that's not the only, that's by far the not even close to the only crazy thing about these guys. This wasn't the car with the extra juice.
They had, later on when they brought the car back here, they were trying to hide nitrous bottles in it. And
right.
Weld it into the floorboards and stuff and cheat. And they're just nuts. And they were doing things like, their car had no sponsorships because they were making money through nefarious ways and funding their racing. But racing
it's
is
that
so,
cartel on the side.
Racing is so car dash. So racing is so expensive that everyone immediately gets suspicious. Where's your sponsorship?
Right.
How can you afford this? So then they create a perfume company to then put on the side of their car, but the perfume company, they create a bunch of the suntan lotion and stuff like that that doesn't actually exist, so they can make anyway. So then they end up going to prison. Then they get out. He dies day before yesterday in a plane crash. He was piloting it. He's the guy who the story goes with, first off, a P-51 Mustang. Now, this isn't the plane he crashed. A P-51 Mustang is the hairiest plane from World War II. That's the plane that Tom Cruise owns, but it's one of the only trainers.
Okay.
Tom Cruise would never fly a P-50 Mustang solo.
Sure.
It's too insane. But it's a very fast plane. It's a plane we put out at the end of World War II and hauled ass. It was like the fastest piston-driven plane of World War II. Anyway, he buys one, and he's going to race it in the Reno Air Races, which is the craziest event ever. It's racing with airplanes around pylons. They get 8 feet off the ground on a fucking airplane going 400 miles an hour. It's nuts. And then in Reno tells some other guys that who are like flying back to Florida or something or Texas, he goes, I'm gonna fly the Mustang. I'm gonna fly this crazy single seat World War II, 1940s vintage, whatever.
Of course you are.
I'll meet you in Florida or Texas, or he's going to meet these guys. I'm going to take the Mustang. And then he goes out to fly the Mustang back to Texas and hits a fog bank over the Gulf of Texas and then has to ditch the place, has to ditch the plane into the Gulf of
like full Texas. On ejector seat?
No ejector seats in those flights. You just feathered them and just
he glided it into the water, basically.
Oh, Don, his brother, ditched a P-51, not Bill. Damn. Yeah, you do what's called flare it. They call it like you come in on your glide slope. Yeah. You're coming in on glide slope, and the last second you just pull back a little, pull a little wheelie, and set the rear end first, and see if you can kind of coast in. But
I guess what Tom Hardy did in Dunkirk.
Right.
That's basically what he did. Then later on ends up in prison, and then but his brother Bill is the one, I guess, who died in the plane. Now, he was piloting, probably trying to do something crazy in the plane, if I know him. Not a military plane, just like a twin engine, whatever. Oh. But so now one of the Whittingtons is gone. I don't know if his brother Don is still around. I think he is. But
it was a life fully lived.
Yeah, it's also one of those things where you do all these crazy races, you do all these crazy airplane things, you run with all these crazy gun-toting guys, you end up in prison for a long time, and then at the very end, you just die in a plane crash.
Yeah.
Kind of appropriate.
The other thing I wanted to get into is... speaking of cars, I don't know.
Don's still alive, by the way.
Oh, Don's still alive. All right. So here's an interesting thing. It has to do with the well-being. I talked to someone on Take a Knee about, you know, well-being and about resetting your system and kind of shocking your system and resetting your system. And then we were kind of talking about... things you could do, like you could do the mindfulness stuff, you can meditate, you can whatever, but you can quickly kind of reset your system, sort of like why everyone feels so great after a 20-minute nap.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Just go down, sure. 15, 20-minute nap, and you reset your system. And I said, yeah, I think the cold water plunge resets your system. Yeah. And then I started thinking about this, and so maybe people want to do this. So I was thinking extreme cold will reset you. You just need to reset.
Kind of shock yourself a little.
Right. The plan is you don't think about anything for 2 minutes, and then you're
out of your head.
Yeah. Right. Now you're back. Now you're rebooted versus sort of run down.
Right.
But I was interviewing Tucker Carlson last week, and he was talking about his like extreme hot saunas. And I said, I couldn't go into a sauna if I was in the midst of writing a 20-page opening monologue, which he writes for his show almost every day, I would just sit in the sauna and my head would be like, oh, now I got this idea. Right. Oh, now I got that idea. I'd be sitting there. And then he said, oh, but once you get to 180 degrees, you have no ideas.
What?
And I thought, oh, yeah, that makes sense. I have no ideas when I'm in a cold, freezing pool. I have no ideas about, I got to write this or I got to remember to bring that up. Yeah. And it's like, if you go pure hot, you sit around 110, 120 degrees, you'll sit there and have ideas. You get to 180 plus, you don't have ideas.
You're just sweating.
How long do you sit in there before you keel over?
You sit in, he said he sat in there about 20 minutes, get out, take a break, then go back in for 20 minutes. But either way, the moral of the story, kids, is you need to reset yourself constantly. If you think about the opposite of resetting is you eating chips in front of the TV for hours on end. That's you not resetting. You dunking yourself in freezing water for 2 minutes is a reset, and you getting in a piping hot sauna for 15 minutes or 5 minutes or whatever, that's a reset. So think about ways to reset.
I was trying to find the name of that show, and I don't know if they're even still doing it, but this flies in the face a little, but I'm sure it wasn't 180. Remember the Gabrielle Reese podcast that she had when she would do it inside the sauna? Yeah. I think it was called The Truth Barrel.
That's that. Yes.
That that would be
she,
a tough
she came
cut.
In here to promote it. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You go into the hot sauna and then you'd go into the freezing pool. Ugh. And then Laird Hamilton would put a bunch of dumbbells in your underpants and tell you to walk
the
from the shallow end to the
at the bottom of the pool.
To the deep end.
Right.
I know everything was about training for the big wave fall, but I'm like, yeah, stay on the board. We don't have to worry about this.
I'm going to say something I never thought before, but I agree wholeheartedly with Tucker Carlson. Back, I used to do the poor man's version of this, which was my gym has a sauna and a steam room. Whoa, yeah. Sweet. Steam room is even harder because it's like hot water basically.
Humidity.
Surrounding you. I'd go steam room, I'd go sauna for a while, 20, 30 minutes. Cold shower, like all the way cold for like right. 5 minutes, right back into the steam room because you're supposed to do the alternating hot and cold.
Right. And what were you thinking about then?
No, nothing.
Nothing.
I was in ignorance bliss.
Right. How your balls probably went really low, then really high, really low. Really.
So yo-yo balls.
Right. Yeah, that's yeah. It's like he was testing the landing gear out on a plane. So the point is find that and reboot and reset and do it. Do it with those. They have those like one man saunas now. Just plug them in. You know, they're small.
Plug in?
Yeah. They're pretty accessible.
Wow.
Yeah, they're pretty accessible now.
Registry.
last but not least, everyone was talking about that video with the 16-year-old and the knife and the cop, and they're getting different angles on it. And everyone has their ideas about firing warning shots. Joy Behar wanted him to fire a warning shot
like
and all that
West.
Kind of stuff. I don't know.
Dance!
She wouldn't have probably wanted that if someone had peeled back a knife and was going to plunge it into her, but good enough for her. But anyway, there's another part of that video that I kept kind of noticing, but no one else really noticed it, which is the cop pulls up and there's whatever the scuffle has spilled out to the lawn. Mm-hmm. And then the cop pulls up in the cop car. It's daytime. Like, a couple of things. Back in the day when the cops pulled up, it was time to, like, pour your beer out. Mm-hmm. And if you're holding a knife, you throw it into a hedge or
swallow
something.
Your roach.
Swallow the roach. Pour the beer out. Yep. Like, the fucking popo pulled up in a cruiser. It's not time to escalate.
Correct.
The cop pulled up. But the cop pulled up. And he got out of the car and he was like telling everyone to cool it. And then the chick with the knife charged and she knocked over this other gal with the dreads, who I'm presuming is a minor because they blurred her face out. But the part, then the cop like showed up to that, like, what's going on? He started to draw his gun. As he was drawing his gun, a guy, an adult male, did a full football drop kick on the chick that was on the ground. Did you guys notice that?
I haven't seen the video.
You can watch it. It's not as crazy as trying to stab somebody with a knife in front of a cop, but it's up there. It's I'd say a general disregard for the law. So he comes up and he's like, "What's going on?" She pushes this chick down. The chick falls down, and the guy does a full kicks her in the face. With the cop standing 3 feet away from him, pulling his gun out. Yeah. And this guy's like, I think now would be a good time to drop kick this chick.
There's another angle? Hold
laying
on.
Laying on the ground.
The cop. Yeah.
So you got the body cam. The chick goes down. Look at this guy's kick.
Oh.
He's standing right in front of the cop who's got his gun out, and he's going to kick a teenage girl in the head who's laying on
That's
the ground.
Crazy.
I'm just saying, people, when the cops show up, keep the feet on the ground.
Mellow out.
Drop the knife. It's going to be
kicking.
No kicking.
Yeah.
Less kicking.
I don't know what your relationship with the law is. The cop is standing 3 feet from you, and he's pulling his gun out of the holster. And you go, now would be a good time to go full Doug Flutie on this.
Wow, drop kick.
Drop kick.
Last one in NFL history.
Full Doug Flutie on this teenage chick's head who's laying at the cop's feet.
Yeah.
Sadly, the Doug Flutie thing, we could explain it to Gina, but I don't think she would have any appreciation whatsoever.
No.
I feel like I get it. I get the general vibe.
Yeah.
Sadly, you don't.
Oh, okay.
No, he did a crazy thing that had not been done in 30 years, but it doesn't look that impressive if you don't like know the mechanics of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
yes.
Lost on me.
Yes. All right. Let's see. Let me hit, and we got the Rotten Tomatoes game to play with that Ron Funches. Essay, multi-use face shields, the perfect piece of protective gear for your next adventure. Perfect for your next outdoor adventure. Whether you're working in the sun or the cold, or hunting or hiking or fishing or skiing or biking, dozens of eye-catching designs for men, women, and children. One size fits all, machine washable, and a lifetime warranty as well. In partnership with Operation Gratitude, they've donated over 100,000 face shields to those on the front lines of the pandemic. So for every order, SA donates one face shield to a first responder. So a good cause and a better product. SA, multi-use face shields, right, Dawson?
Stay protected outdoors, because right now you can get an insane deal. Buy one, get four free $150 value for just $24.99. Go to safishing.com/Adam to get five face shields for the price of one, plus a lifetime warranty and free returns if you're not satisfied. That's safishing.com/Adam.
All right, take a quick break. Back with comedian Ron Funches right after this.
It's time for Nicaraguan Name That Movie with Adam's buddy Oswaldo. See if you can guess which movie this famous line is from.
Yes, when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
If you said The Godfather Part 3.
Just when I thought I was out, they pulled me back in.
You're correct. Now, back to the show.
Ron Funches has joined us. The movie Golden Arm, it's available on Apple TV Digital and select theaters on Friday. Official selection of the 2020 South by Southwest Film Festival. Thank you very much. And the podcast Getting Better with Ron Funches as well. Good to see you, Ron.
Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
I have not seen Golden Arm yet because I don't think it was made available for us to see, but we'll talk about it in a second. But I was just watching you on The Last Blockbuster, the documentary on Netflix on The Last Blockbuster video store, which is kind of interesting doc.
Yeah, it's really interesting. They reached out to me and just came to my house. I was familiar. I mean, of course, very familiar with Blockbuster. Spent many a night in there as my youth. And then I was familiar with The Last Blockbuster because I lived in Bend, Oregon for a time. And so it was really fun to talk about.
Yeah, it's a strangely compelling documentary. I don't know why. It doesn't sound like it would be, you know, the stuff of compelling docs, but it's very compelling. It's a good doc.
Yeah, I think it's when something is so ubiquitous to us that's like always around us that we think it's going to be there forever in our youth, and then it's just gone. Like, you have just an interest in it, whether it's like, you know, an old toy or an old video store. The fact that it was such a big part of childhood, a big part of how things have changed now, to where you don't have that like feel of, is it going to be there? Is the thing I want available? You just go and click a button. And so our, you know, our kids seem like that. They don't have any idea what that fun was like of like running into your friends at a Blockbuster or things like that. It was, I think it's interesting to talk about.
Or the horror of picking up the white box and going, it's here, and having nothing behind it to take to the counter. That was the worst feeling.
Yeah, I think what we're really talking about is foreplay. Mm-hmm. Like, if you really think about, I don't know, I've never really thought about it, but life is sort of, the rules that apply sexually will apply to life, you know? Your impulse is, I got to get my dick in some pussy or some asshole or in a mouth or something like now.
Right, sure.
But we all know it's better if you go to a nice dinner. Uh-huh. And you light it.
Put your dick in the steak.
And you put your dick right in the waitress's mouth. No, you light a candle. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's just better, but we don't want to do it. Right. But it's better. And the on demand, like my kids with 10,000 movies, they don't have that foreplay of like get in the car, drive
the
here, not sure if they got it.
Yeah. Dude, Disney Plus, like with everything just available from the entire catalog from Snow White to today. Like, remember, like things would come out for a limited time.
Back in the vault. It's going back in the vault.
No, you had a month to watch Pinocchio.
Right.
Yeah, these kids are just coming all over the place anytime they want. They don't know what it's like to get a little bit of blue balls, to get a little bit of rejection. They're just fucking whatever they want.
Yep. That's exactly what they're doing these days.
Did you guys do the same sad thing that I did when I was like 11 or 12 and like I wanted to see Batman, but Blockbuster was obviously rented out or whatever it was. I would kind of stand by the drop box and like, hey, what that person just drop off? of course. I had nothing to do when I was 12.
Where there was always the promise of maybe it got dropped off, but it hasn't been restocked. Yeah, right.
Check the counter.
You have to go check the counter, right?
Yes, checking the counter. That was one. That was the move that made you feel like an insider.
So, Golden Arm. Let's talk about that one for a second. I don't know anything about it, so tell us. Catch us up.
It is a wonderful comedy that stars Mary Holland, Betsy Sidero, Eugene Cordero, myself, many others. It's basically a female buddy comedy take of over the top. It's an arm wrestling movie starring two hilarious ladies. And I play Carl, the owner of the arm wrestling establishment and lover and purveyor of strong women. So I just stay being myself.
So good.
And like I said, it'll be in select theaters. I guess people should go to a website that's not probably.
Yeah, just get it on demand. Go to Amazon. It'll be available at all the on demand things.
Or eat your finer movies.
How
Blockbuster.
Ron, I'm looking at the bottom of my thing here. It says you once weighed 360 pounds. How did you lose all that weight?
I just started exercising, stopped eating bad food.
Hold on, let me write that.
Yeah, I gotta make sure I heard that correctly.
That sounds like foreplay to me.
I know. People always like, what happened? Did you what surgery or magical bullet? But it was literally I started exercising and I started drinking protein shakes and stopped eating Philly cheesesteaks.
I know. People hate that news because it means they should be doing it too.
Yeah, I know.
Well, what else did you do?
Yeah.
Some herbal supplement.
Yeah. How much fenfen did you supplement with that?
You worked with a holistic healer, right. Coffee enemas. Come on, it's got to be something.
What was on your vision board?
I know, the worst answer. I had a friend that was real heavy, and then he wasn't. And I said, what did you do? And he went, I started walking. And he's like, that's about it.
Next.
Yeah.
I know it's amazing how many diet books are sold when it's really just what you're not supposed to eat, what you are supposed to eat, and we all know the part about you breaking a sweat.
That's right.
I cannot believe and how long have you had the weight off?
It's been 3-4 years now. Been keeping it off, staying focused on it. Trying to push it a little bit more. So it's just constant part of my life and just knowing that that's going to be a struggle. But I mean, it saved my life in the pandemic, just knowing that like in the morning, I'm going to go lift weights. And if I had nothing to do in the night, I'm going to go lift weights, go on that treadmill, gave me something to do.
I know you got some dates coming up. Wise Guys, Salt Lake City, which is a fun club to play, and Stand Up Live at Phoenix as well. Wise Guys, May 7th and 8th, and June 4th and 5th in Phoenix at Stand Up Live. Are you doing a lot of dates? Have you been doing dates?
No, a lot of comedians have been fighting against this void of like, the pandemic, doing the Zoom shows. I've done occasional Zoom show, but mostly I just gave in. I was like, I'll just start over when it's time to get back on the road. I don't mind sucking for a little while. I've just been doing a lot of voiceovers, a lot of acting. I'm hosting a new show, Chop 420, on the Discovery Plus app, which is fun because I get to eat food that's full of weed and get paid to get high and really show my mom that she was wrong on all accounts when it came to me.
Ron cracked the code on the pandemic in every way, between the exercising and the TV work and everything.
I've been very blessed. I just keep my head down and count my blessings, girl.
Can you stay on a schedule? Had you stayed on a schedule with the pandemic? Because I think that's the hard part for a lot of people. Like, they don't have to get up or be anywhere or catch a plane, so then they start drifting.
Yeah, no, that's exactly it. But I think, I've always had the ability to drift for the last few years if I wanted to. I don't have, I kind of keep my own schedule. So, I just been good at keeping that schedule. That's why I have the workouts there to book in my days. And then I I'm either writing something, working on something. There's no more. That's the thing. Like you said, the instant gratification is just the stuff that I miss. I miss the pop of going out and do crowds. So I'm excited to get back on to do some shows. But I was going out like, you know, 3 weekends a month and doing shows when I was home and then acting and doing stuff on the weekdays, burning myself out. So I don't really want to get back to that. I think maybe 1 or 2 weekends a month will be my max in the future and just keep working on acting and other stuff because I'm liking it.
Here's circling back to Blockbuster. Here's an interesting philosophical question for everybody. I've noticed that there is value in recognition of names of brands that are defunct. And I like cars. And so it's like Bugatti was gone for 70 years and then Bugatti came back. Like someone goes,
was it literally gone or was it like no one paid attention to it?
I think it was, Chris can check, but I think Bugatti was literally gone for a number of years. They hung out, made little attempts, but they seem to be gone. Alfa Romeo was kind of gone. There's like these companies were gone. Mm-hmm. And then they came back, you know, new management, new ownership, new structures, you know, some German company or something ends up buying them. But there's some value in the fact that we know what Bugatti is. Bugatti was defunct in 1963 and then came back with a supercar that set the land speed record, essentially. But what does that mean? There's some value in Blockbuster? Like,
I think it's ironic value. I don't think anyone would actually go to a Blockbuster to get a movie.
It's nostalgia.
Well, they're not going to go under the old model.
Right.
Is there a Blockbuster streaming channel or a Blockbuster something that is not
that? That's a good point.
Yeah, because that's the thing. Like, the Netflix model was not turn on your TV and watch anything you want. It was stick it in the mail.
Yeah,
it'll
mail
come to you when it comes
disc.
To you. And they evolve. So I think you're right. I think for our generation, it would be badass to have like a Blockbuster streaming channel.
And as much as, you know, no publicity is bad publicity, like the ironic nostalgia is just nostalgia. You know, at the end of the day, it's like, yeah, you can like it ironically, but it's still something you're thinking about.
You're still paying for it.
Well, we're talking about they're making movies out of Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
That's right.
And they're making movies out of, they're making all these dumb movies from toys that we remember when we were kids.
Mm-hmm. Legos are huge.
Some value in it. Thoughts, Ron?
I mean, that's what I pitched in the documentary. Why not a Blockbuster dispensary? Just some place where you could go smoke, pick out your latest movie, meet some friends. I just want a general hangout spot. It's not going to be probably a very profitable business, but that's why the weed's there to prop it up for me.
So you grew up out here in SoCal and then moved to Chicago. Was that your childhood?
Yeah, I'm bowling. Yeah, for 4 years. I was here till I was four. Moved to Chicago, moved to Oregon, and then came back here.
And the Oregon was the Blockbuster chapter in your life.
Mm-hmm. And Chicago. Well, I guess in Chicago, we also had Hollywood Video.
Oh yeah.
Better.
Yeah. God. Mm-hmm.
They had a porn section.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Blockbuster never had a porn section.
Blockbuster would sometimes take out controversial scenes or like extreme violence, and that didn't sit well with a lot of, you know, movie purists.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
I know that.
Oh, yeah. That was it's well documented.
Wow.
Yeah. The Walmart style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, it seems weird to try to compete minus porn back then. It seems like you're hobbling yourself.
Yeah,
that's all the little ones had, the little stores, because Blockbuster was the only game in town.
And it kept the beaded curtain people in business.
That's right.
Because who else is buying that?
The beaded door jam, yeah. Mm-hmm. I went to a place that had Western doors, which I always liked that. Yeah, the saloon doors. Ron, where'd you rent your porn back in the day?
New sheriff in town.
Well, they wouldn't let me. By the time I could rent porn, that was gone. So I, you know, my young porn days were watching the scrambled pornography on the pay-per-views where you could hear the noises and just hope to make out a nipple or, you know, what you or use your imagination. You could make it whatever you want at the time.
I remember once trying to take a picture of a TV set that had nudity on it, like a literally like a Polaroid. That's how fucking insane.
It's a hard up you were.
Yeah.
And I think when you're young, you like, you'll just find sex scenes that I remember, Wild Things, one of my favorite movies. I think there was a scene in Muriel's Wedding that I could masturbate to as a teen. I found it.
Oh, I forgot about that.
As a teen, though, you can masturbate just about anything.
That's true. I don't know. Man, I could still get it going to Muriel's Wedding. Why not?
Yeah, I had one of my earliest masturbatory mashups as a teen is I loved Linda Carter from Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. And I loved Cheryl Ladd from Charlie's Angels. Mm-hmm. I had those two meeting in my mind.
Wow. Getting to know each other?
Yes.
A crossover episode?
Yes. There was no... It didn't actually exist, right. But I willed it.
That's great. Nice. Superpower.
You use that golden lasso. You get everything involved.
Oh, we got the truth. We got the truth out of Cheryl.
Battle the Network Stars.
Battle the Network Stars was the best back then. Probably, Ron, you're probably a little young for Battle the
Network
Stars.
Yeah, I don't remember
Network
that one. American Gladiators is what I remember. Mm-hmm. But I loved them. I think they're doing a 30 for 30 on American Gladiators. I can't
wait. Oh, really?
Wait. Oh, I'd like to see that.
Sweet.
Yeah, I would watch a 30 for 30 on Tupperware. Like, that's how we do 30 for 30. Empty Tupperware. Yeah. I don't care. That's how much I like 30 for 30. But I wonder when that's coming out. Where'd you hear that, Ron?
I just saw it on Twitter and it got me excited because I love Turbo. I love all the people. Mm-hmm. I love contestants. Wesley Two Scoops Berry. I used to have a bit about Wesley Two Scoops Berry that I would do. The only competitor that became a gladiator. I love him.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I used to watch it a little bit. It was always... Were you always rooting for the contestant? I was always rooting for the contestant.
I was usually rooting for the contestant unless they were overly cocky and then I wanted them to get taken out.
Sure.
And then they also had that one gladiator, I think that was a lady named Storm, and I liked her because I could tell that she was like Storm from the X-Men Storm. And I was like, I like that too.
Well, I'm seeing right here, just from Twitter, a revival of the popular physical competition show American Gladiators is in the works from Seth Rogen.
Oh, that makes sense.
Maybe there will be a 420
element.
They rebooted
it a couple times. Nice. Gina Carano was in the like 05, 06 version. She was like Crush or something.
Yeah, I guess the theme is everything's just coming back.
Yeah.
Everything that you've... If you've heard of it, it has some value, right? Because you went, have you heard of this thing? And you go, yes, I have. And they go, really? All right, now it has value. Now we're going to do it. How's your son doing, Ron?
He's doing great. We just had his 18th birthday a couple days ago.
We're
very happy. I feel like I won an NBA championship over here. I was like, new feelings. I didn't know what it was like to have an adult kid. But as soon as he turned 18, I was just like, I'm so proud of me. That's how far I've made.
It's the son. It's not the daughter.
No, he took his kid.
Where'd he go? Where'd he go? He went.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Hey, buddy. We got Ron Funches in here. And he's got bunches of fun with him. Speaking of fun, that's his son. Oh, he just turned 18. You get yourself a knee high. Ronnie, get yourself a protein shake. Rest here. Quit your grinning and drop your linen. Jade, stage seven. Ron's a big celebrity. Come on, he's doing stand-up all over. You guys seen the Golden Hour movie? Oh, no one here has? Well, how about that Blockbuster movie on that? Nobody? Okay, stop. Listen, you threatened me. That's a federal law right there, buddy. Hey, buddy. Ron Burton. Now, if Ron's son was Jewish, he'd be 189 by now because he already would have been a man. But he don't swing that way. He turned 18, so get him a knee high and a Shirley Temple. Get Ron a Muscle Milk and let's get up there and shake that moneymaker. Ron ain't going to make it rain, but he might make it drizzle. Give him change for a dollar. Let's see if this happens. Thank you. Sorry, no, I got the...
Was it like that?
How was the party?
Was that the birthday?
No, we just went and saw Mortal Kombat. It was fun. We saw a bunch of fatalities. That was good.
That's helpful.
Pretty sweet.
Yeah.
Oh, you saw Mortal Kombat.
Mm-hmm.
I passed a billboard for that. I was like, is that a thing? Good. Is it good?
New movie.
It was good. If you like the game, if you into the mythos, yes.
Oh, it's streaming on HBO as HBO well. Max, yeah. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, but you went into the theater?
Yeah, I rented out a theater. It's
oh, you rented
my son
it out?
And my wife nice. Just hung, just the Ooh, three of us, and we watched the movie. It truly was. It was his 18th birthday.
That is awesome.
So, wait a minute. This is a power move. Just the three of you in the theater?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
How is that these days? Is it, you can get it at a better price because they're yes. at half capacity or whatever?
Oh, so much better. I mean, to be honest with you, it was like $200. Yeah, why not just do this every time?
I know a couple of friends who've done this, and the AMC, at least mm-hmm. by me, is like, you can rent the theater for a new movie for like $300. But if you want to watch like a library selection, like Back to the uh-huh. Future or something like that, it's like $99. You bring
Aww,
up to 20 people.
I would love that.
That's true.
Look at that cute picture.
Is it? Are these matinee? Like, are these daytime prices?
They're
we
all
went at
various.
5. Yeah, we went 5 p.m. We went.
Did you? Are you at the place in Hollywood? Right off of Hollywood there? I'm looking
it
at the picture.
It says El Capitan, I think. No, it doesn't. It's a Scorpion.
Which one? Which one did you go to?
Oh, we went to Cinemark. Cinemark over, I forget where it is. I don't know. But yeah, that's us. Pretend, right afterwards, he said, I'm going to take your spine. When that made me happy, I was like, he's really paid attention to the movie.
That's good.
He retained a lot.
He did.
Wait a minute. But was your wife miserable at least watching Mortal Kombat?
Oh, no, that was the best part. Thank you for bringing it up. It was really fun because at one point I just looked over at her. She's just reacting and she goes, I didn't know it was going to be this violent. And I was like, did you think this was Mortal Kombat? What did you think this was?
All right, let's see. I got a spot here, and then we got the Rotten Tomatoes game. Yes, Gina.
Real quick before we get off this tip, if anyone's interested, I'm not saying that I'm in it, but I will say that the new installment of Street Fighter V has come out with the character Rose. Mm-hmm. Gigi Harris, for union reasons, is back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my married name will be Harris. And my new Rose is out on Street Fighter V. So people seem
You're
pretty excited about that.
You're doing the VO for
yeah,
that?
Yeah, I always do for Rose.
Check that out. I'll play that on my Twitch.
Oh, good.
Playing a lot of games on my Twitch.
Oh, that's me. It's the music.
That's
though.
You?
Uh-huh. Yeah,
You're Rose?
I'm Rose, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I'm the guy Rose is fighting, too, Ron, if you're impressed. Slacks. Well, they call it slacks.
I have always wanted to be a voice in a video game, so I'm very much and truly impressed.
Oh, well,
this.
Good.
Take this in the spirit which is intended, Ron, but I don't know if you can sound menacing.
Oh, I can.
Oh, you can?
I can. Well, if I have to.
All right, so let's see if we can work this out. Say, I shall take your spine and eat it like linguine.
Okay. I'm going to take your spine and eat it like linguine.
Oh, you know what? Good. I stand corrected.
I got a little chill on my neck.
I stand corrected.
Thank you.
Woo.
Thank you so much.
For a second, I thought it was directed at me, and I was like, back off, Ron. Yeah. All right, let's see if we can try a few more of these wild lines just to see.
Okay. Menacing. Menacing.
All right. Menacing. All right. I will. I'm going to punch my hand through your rib cage and pull out your heart.
I'm going to punch my hand through your rib cage and then I'm going to pull out your heart if you don't mind.
Yeah, that's good. I like you putting your own flavor at the end there.
This is nightmare fuel.
Okay. Let's see. Okay. I'm going to vanquish you and then have sex with your fiance in front of your corpse.
I'm going to vanquish you and then have sex with your fiance in front of your corpse because that's what she wanted. And I'm just trying to give her what she needs.
Wow.
That's a little menacing.
I didn't think it was going to work.
Yeah, it does.
At first, Ron, but man.
I'm scared.
I stand. Let's just do like 27 more of these.
No news.
Let's see. Let's try this. I'm going to rip off your left ear, saute it, and eat it while you bleed out on the ground.
I'm going to rip off your left ear, saute it, Just make sure I have a nice oil and garlic melody for flavor. And then I'm going to eat it while you bleed out. I don't even have the time to finish you off.
That's good.
That's really chilling.
Mm-hmm. That one scared me.
Yeah. Well, look, I know we got a lot of high-end video producers who listen to the show. So if you people are checking this out, you may want to blow Ron's phone up because I think there's something here. And also, in all seriousness, you know, the way over the it's all been done
before.
It's played out. Mm-hmm.
But that smile is freaky.
Yeah.
You want someone who has a joy in the murdering.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
I like that.
Great big smile.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Much more menacing. All right. Let me hit Sunday here. Oh, brown spots, weeds, all that on your front lawn. Nobody wants that. And spring has sprung, baby. So you can get custom lawn care, and they'll put a plan together from Sunday. It takes a guesswork out of unwanted chemicals, so you can grow a beautiful lawn that's better for people, better for pets, better for the planet. Mike August is all over this. He absolutely loves it. He uses Sunday. You get to Sunday. It's the website is getsunday.com. Put your home address in. And they'll give you a free lawn analysis. It's a tool. It takes care of the rest in just seconds. Sunday uses soil and climate data to create a tailored nutrient plan. See, this is what we need, a smart lawn. Everything is sent straight to your door, and it's right when you need it. Get a beautiful, beautiful lawn this year. With Sunday, right, Dawson?
Let Sunday take the guesswork out of growing a greener, more beautiful lawn this spring. Visit GetSunday.com/Adam to get $20 off your custom lawn plan at checkout. That's $20 off your custom plan at GetSunday.com/Adam.
All right, we'll take a quick break, come back with Ron, and we'll play the Rotten Tomatoes game. And we expect a lot out of you, Ron, because you know movies, right after this.
Hey, Ron. So, yeah, for this game, we just guess the Rotten Tomatoes score. We'll give you a movie, and everyone guesses the score, and then we tally it all up to see who got closest overall.
But you
got
to write it down.
We'll have him go
or
first.
We can go first.
Sorry.
And we're looking for the critic score.
The critic score.
Here we go.
Got you.
Listen to that noise. It's a high falsetto. Some names are flicks, and the gang makes their picks, guessing if it's rotten or fresh.
If they guess it exactly, we'll get a bonus five.
It's the Rotten Tomatoes game. You know how we do it. Give me the Rotten Tomatoes game. Now it's time to play it.
Well, it's Oscar Sunday as we record this. And since Bald Brian finally lost a round of the Rotten Tomatoes game last week that was Oscar-centric, we're going for it again.
Come on.
Yes.
This week, a category he probably knows even less about. Movies that won the Oscar for Best Makeup and Hairstyling.
Oh.
How dare you?
You can turn on your mic if you want to talk.
I can hear him.
Yeah. Some might say it's on too much. Crazy, Chris.
Fun fact, this Oscar category was created in 1981 after the Academy received complaints that The Elephant Man, which was released in 1980, would not be honored. And so one year later, Rick Baker took home the very first Oscar for this category for transforming a college student into a terrifying werewolf from 1981. An American Werewolf in London.
Never saw it.
Yeah, I think I saw it. It was like, okay. I think it had the guy from the Dr. Pepper commercial.
Yes, in the red jacket. Yeah.
Yeah, probably he's song and dance guy.
He
Gina
is.
Knows
he
him
is.
From
I can't think
Broadway.
Of his name. Yep.
All right. And it was like a bit of a hit, but I don't even know if it was good. I just remember it was kind of people liked it.
Is that Griffin Dunne next to him?
Probably. It seems about right. All right. So it did great.
Yes, it is.
As far as it is Griffin Dunne. Did great in the makeup department, but what about the score?
I'll think about the musical score. I was like, what are you talking about?
Well, I thought he was talking about Warren Zevon.
I think it had the Warren Zevon song in it, Werewolf of London, I think. All right, I say... God. All right, so we're all going to write our numbers down, and Ron, you can just shout out what you thought the critics did on this one.
Go for it.
You ready for me now?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Well, I feel, I mean, just from the matching jackets alone, I feel like that's a good, they're going to get solid score. I know that makeup and hair don't mean it's a good movie, but I do feel like in this time of back in this time, good makeup, good effects really push things. I feel like this is a classic 75.
Ooh.
I feel like this is one of those movies.
Ron and I are simpatico. I want 76.
I want 77. Gina, please tell me that 78.
I didn't.
Or 74.
I know Rick Baker. No, I know Rick Baker's super, you know, everybody knows that name and he's mainstream, but I don't know anything about this movie. I didn't even think it'd be fresh. I said 60.
Mm. An American Werewolf in London is certified fresh at 87%.
Wow.
Yeah, it's
so
like a,
high.
It's a classic.
People had it at 85.
Well, here's another fun fact. You probably noticed we referred to this Oscar category as best makeup and hairstyling. But in fact, prior to 2012, the category was simply called best makeup. Clearly, some impressive hairdos needed to be recognized, so in 2012, the first official Oscar for Best Makeup and Hairstyling went to this super depressing musical about the French Revolution, starring Hugh Jackman, Russell Crowe, and Anne Hathaway. From 2012, Les Misérables.
I have thoughts.
You must have thoughts. I hated this so much.
Thoughts. You know how you said it was nerdy impressive when I said instead of it's better than the book's better, that the stage show is better? Mm-hmm. This is a classic example of the stage show being better than the movie.
It looked good though, right?
Sure. I mean, the budget
won a bunch
was,
of awards.
It was
best
sweeping.
Actress.
Yeah.
For what's her face singing straight to the camera.
Turns out Russell Crowe, not a great singer.
not a good singer. Not an average singer.
Ron,
but
thoughts on this?
Oh, I have lots of thoughts on Les Misérables. It is also, it's one of my favorite musicals. Mm-hmm. I remember going to see this movie during the very beginnings of my divorce with another lady friend. And I was like, things are going to be okay. I think I remember the critics actually really liking this movie, if I'm correct. So I'm going to give this an 80.
Ooh, I'm not ready.
I haven't written mine down yet.
I haven't written mine down yet either.
The best picture, perhaps.
God, that's what are we in backwards land?
It won a bunch of a few awards.
Oh boy.
I don't know. I was listening to Brian about how much he hated it.
I absolutely did hate it, but
it
I'm telling you,
bad.
It won a bunch of awards.
It's pretty bad.
And Gina, how much she
bad.
Hated
yeah.
it. What does that mean?
I don't know.
But Ron loved it, but maybe because he was going through a very painful divorce.
Probably.
Mm-hmm. That can add 25 points to a score. All right. Everyone in?
Yeah.
I went 63.
Nope, 68.
72.
Les Misérables is fresh at 70.
Oh, good. I needed that.
All right. We're all.
Audience score, though. That's close. With
79. Yeah. We're all pretty knotted up here. It's anyone's game at this point.
But the tigers come at night with their voices soft as thunder as they tear your hope apart, as they turn your dreams to shame. Go ahead.
It's my favorite
that.
Warren Zevon song.
I gotta delete that drop.
Hold on, it's my turn. Pete Ellis Dodge, Long Beach Freeway, Firestone Exit, Southgate. It's all I got.
That was really good.
Transformers!
More than meets the eye.
All right, Ron, it's your turn.
Let's do a story about a man named Jay. Poor mountaineer barely gets his family fed.
Then all right, we've all contributed. All right, here we go.
All right. Now we live in an era of superhero films, which are not exactly Academy Awards material, but thanks to categories like Best Makeup and Hairstyling, Comic book movies can now claim they took home an Oscar. Like this film, which follows a team of super villains, including the now iconic blue and red pigtails of Harley Quinn, Will Smith, Jared Leto, and Margot Robbie star in 2016's Suicide Squad.
Brian loved this.
I enjoyed small portions of this movie.
What did Jared Leto have on his head?
Damaged. So you know he's damaged.
Right.
So this is the first one, right?
They're James Gunn's coming out with a reboot sequel to this summer, which may or may not be good.
Wait, Ron, you doing a voice on Harley Quinn cartoon?
Yeah, I do. I'm King Shark.
Ooh.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So me and Sylvester Stallone, they only go with legends.
And you, and only, and the aforementioned over the top as well.
That's
so
right.
You guys, you got a lot in common with Sly.
No, that's my plan, to just take all of his movies and reboot them myself and just be like, hi, Adrian.
Well, let's see. If I was Drago and I said, I must break you, what would you say?
Oh, you look scary.
Well, wait a minute. Hold on. Wait, was it Mr. T? Okay, ready? I predict pain.
What's your prediction for the fight?
Pain. Don't you say go for it at some point?
No, that's I'm going to bust you up.
I'm going to bust you up, sucker.
Go for it.
Hold on. I'll do the black voices around here. Ron, stifle yourself.
Okay.
You do yourself as Stallone. I'm going to bust you up, sucker.
Okay, I don't think you sound black.
Well, I didn't want to go over the top like I normally do when I'm just with white people.
Too uncomfortable.
A lot of hello there.
Yeah. All right. This movie was a disappointment, but it doesn't mean it was bad. It was disappointing, right?
It was.
People
were
waiting for it.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
just
yeah.
kind of disappointing.
Will Smith was the de facto star.
Right.
Mm-hmm. He's always the de facto star.
True. This should have been an ensemble piece, but he was a big star.
This is a very watchable movie, would you say? Maybe that's just because all the great star power. All right.
There's portions of it I enjoy.
I want to take this movie past fail and just say if it's rotten or not.
All right.
Okay.
Now, they do give a couple of extra points for a strong kick-ass female in the lead. Right. So there might be a couple of points on there. But I don't think they like this one. Ron, what do you say?
I mean, I get confused because I think about the other Harley Quinn movie that was enjoyable. That one was fun. But I think I remember this one being really bad and the only person being good, and it was Viola Davis. I think I'm going to give this a 60.
Oh,
hold on. Let me do my Viola Davis for you. All right. I'll do it after the show.
Okay.
Yeah,
This is a bad movie, but not like a zero bad. I said 41.
Ooh.
What'd you say, Gina?
I didn't say yet.
I said 52.
I said 48.
Suicide Squad is rotten. A 26%.
Lower. Damn. Mm.
I forget how bad these can go.
Oh, yeah.
We've had a zero.
We've had some zeros.
I'm right there with the audience just about every time.
Cara Delevingne plays the villain, and she spends half her time on screen just wobbling like an inflatable, like gas station little thing.
Why?
Right. That sounds entertaining.
She's the enchantress. She's under a spell.
Okay.
It's horrible.
Our next film rightly took home the Best Makeup Oscar for a different kind of comic book movie. Based on a comic strip from 1931, this brightly colored crime thriller features larger-than-life characters like Flat Top, Mumbles, Big Boy Caprice, and Breathless Mahoney. Mm. Many of the film stars are unrecognizable, and the cast includes Al Pacino, Dustin Hoffman, Madonna, and Warren Beatty, who not only stars, but also directs from 1990, Dick Tracy.
It's It's weird. Even though 1990 is old, this feels older.
Yeah. Yes, it does.
This was an old style movie in 1990.
That's true.
And remember we used to get all whipped up, like Madonna's going to play something.
Why not Liz Mahoney?
We must have had so little going on in our lives that we just cared that much.
Yes.
Like 9 months out, you know, Madonna's going to play press. God. Oh, boy. Stop the presses.
When she played Evita, half of West Hollywood's heads exploded. God. That was incredible,
Madonna,
I have to say.
Not only played Breathless Mahoney, she also did a song for the soundtrack called I'm Breathless.
Really?
Mahoney. .. Mahoney.
Yes, she did.
Wait a minute. Was that better or worse than Prince's Batuzzi or whatever?
Oh, God. Oh, the Bat Dance.
The Bat Dance.
The Bat Dance is amazing. It's
in the year of each other, by the way.
We should get I'm Breathless and the Bat Dance by Prince and see which one didn't stand the test of time as well.
I want to hear the Bat Dance.
All right.
So
well,
bad.
This is not good. I probably saw half this. It just didn't. It's just one of those things that you thought might have worked out, but it didn't work out. But all-star cast, and then you got
Hollywood legend Warren
Beatty. Warren Beatty directing, which sounds okay. And then maybe we didn't punish movies as badly back then. Maybe the critics would have been all up on it.
It's
this
fun,
time.
Stylized.
I saw this recently, and it's there's some good elements to this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not saying it's a good movie. Mm-hmm. I'm saying there's some good elements to this. Pacino is just over the top. This is where he really started screaming.
All right.
This is before Scent of a Woman. This is 1990.
All right. Ron, what do you got?
Well, I'm going the other way. I'm just going full out of my feelings on this. As a kid, I love this movie. I love everything about it. I love the watches. I still, even looking at this poster, this is one of the most stylish posters you will ever see. The yellow trench coat, everything is iconic in this movie to me. But then I'm going to take a little bit away from that and take in some of the critiques you guys are saying, and I'm going to give it an 82. I feel like this I think this was a great movie.
I went the opposite direction. I went 43.
Wow.
I split your difference. I think it overwhelmed critics with style and star power. I said 62. Mm. Barely fresh.
55. Barely rotten.
Dick Tracy is fresh.
Oh.
At 63.
Oh. Wow.
And here's the to that.
That's it.
Do we have Breathless?
Well, I'm Breathless is actually the name of the album, the entire album that she did. But I think you're looking for the song Vogue, so we'll get that one right.
Oh,
that's the single off.
It's not at all what I'm looking for.
But we like Vogue.
She didn't do what was she sang in the movie?
Yeah, I really thought
she had a song in the movie. I mean,
we know Vogue. Thank you.
Yeah, she did sing in the movie, though. What was that song?
Whatever she sang in the movie. All right. Well, I got some making up to do as we head into the championship rounds.
Well, finally, we return to where it all began. Rick Baker. Since winning the very first Best Makeup Oscar, the man has gone on to be nominated a record-breaking total of 11 times, taking home the statue on 7 different occasions. Past Oscar-winning work includes Men in Black, How the Grinch Stole Christmas, and this film about a family that runs into a Sasquatch and takes him back home to suburbia. John Lithgow and Melinda Dillon lead the cast of this Oscar-winning film from 1987, Harry and the Hendersons.
God, this movie is right in my sweet spot.
One of those ones I can't tell if it's good or bad.
I saw it
100 times as an 11-year-old.
Same.
Ron, you like this one?
Yeah, who doesn't? It teaches you how to love something even if you don't understand it.
The scene where Lithgow's like telling him, like, go, get out of here for his own good is legitimately heartbreaking.
It's a great movie.
This was the sleepover birthday movie.
Yes.
Everybody would watch Harry and the Hendersons.
Did they make a TV show out of this at some point?
It does sound vaguely familiar.
I think they tried to spin this into a TV series.
Yeah, I'm Breathless was featured on the soundtrack. No, I got that one wrong. So
all right.
I figured I'd double down.
All right. I got points to make up.
Me too.
So is Gina. I mean, I think Brian's in the driver's seat here.
Yeah, but this one could be.
Yeah.
This one could be 28 or 82.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fun family film, but is it any good?
It can't be good. On the other hand, some of these family films sometimes score.
Mm-hmm. Paddington 2 is amazing.
Oh, people are still talking about that movie.
They should be.
Yeah, never saw it. Paddington 2.
You got to.
I must. Scary? Was that too scary for you?
No, it's good. All right, Ron, how say you?
I'm going to go 7. I just feel like I don't understand this game. And that scores that I would are way out of the league. So I'm going to say 75.
Ooh. I hedged my bets, which is always a bad move. 52.
I went exceedingly high at 79, knowing I had to make up 25 points.
69.
Nice. Harry and the Hendersons is rotten.
Oh. That'll do it.
Oh.
That'll do it.
At 43%.
Oh.
And here's the Madonna song from Dick Tracy.
Yeah, that's it.
What is this called?
It's called
Sooner or Later.
And won the Oscar for Best Original Song.
Oh, shit.
This is a major audition song for high school and college kids.
Not for the football team. That much I can promise you. They just want to see how fast you can run through cones.
Right.
Madonna was probably dating Warren back then, right?
Oh, yeah.
Wasn't he? Didn't he make a brief appearance in the
Truth or Dare?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. He was great. He was great in that because he showed up. And I think at some point she couldn't speak. She lost her voice. Yeah. She was told by her coach, mm-hmm. you know, her singing coach, like no talking mm-hmm. for a week. And Warren came in and he made like a snarky comment that like, if you can't film her, then why would she be alive? Like sort of like he sort of
yeah.
made this crazy narcissist
right.
comment to the camera sort of in right. front of her. And I said, I think this is the beginning of the end for these kids. Oh, man.
This
started off pretty promising, this game, but it just
ended great.
Yeah, all right, here we go.
So who won second place?
Oh, but before he does the score, Madonna pursued the role of Breathless Mahoney, offering to work for Scale. Her resulting paycheck for the film was just $35,000. Sean Young claimed she was forced out of the role of Tess Trueheart after rebuffing sexual advances from Beatty.
And Catwoman. What other roles does she claim she was canceled from?
Well, for Sean Young, I'm like true.
Yeah.
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 I'm going to give me some of that Madonna money.
Yeah. All right.
Here Gina Grad, congratulations are in order. You have made the podium.
Oh, good.
Consecutively.
Oh, nice.
Well done.
Thank you.
Ron Funches, congratulations to you. You got the highest score.
Nice.
However... The lowest score will win. Ron coming in at 107. Ace man.
Oh, it's like golf.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Keeping it 100.
Yeah.
100 for Adam Carolla. Gina Grad with a nice solid 89.
Oh.
And Bald Brian blew everybody away with his bald head. 37 for the win.
Oh,
wow.
It's
the Bald and Tomatoes game. You know how we do it.
If that were Little League, we would have enacted the slider rule. Four movies in. Jesus Christ. Sad. All right. Let me tell you about Signal Wire, powering the future of remote business communications. A major TV studio recently needed remote actors to re-record and dub their lines. They use Signal Wire's low latency audio and video tech with virtually no sound or video lag. Signal Wire's design mimics the in-office experience, offering quick, informal, unscheduled interactions that are critical to employee productivity and solidifying company culture. This technology is mind-blowingly good. I was on a call or signal wire communication with these guys that have 10 people on the screen, then they'd have 40 people on, and then we'd move to different offices. Smart businesses use Signal Wire to future-proof their business. Sign up before April 30th at signalwire.com with the code ADAM, and they'll buy lunch for your first team meeting. Go to signalwire.com for terms and conditions. That's signalwire.com. Use the code ADAM at signalwire.com. Yes, Gina?
Hey, real quick, because Ron's here and he loves movies and you guys seem to know a thing or two about superheroes, I thought it'd be fun just to tell you this real quick. Are you aware that Michael Keaton will be making a comeback as Batman?
As Batman?
Yes. So it's not going to be in a Batman movie. It's going to be in The Flash.
Mm-hmm.
The Flash movie, Michael Keaton, according to Entertainment Weekly, will be Batman.
Hmm.
Some sort of I'm time excited travel about situation?
It. I don't know. But let's see. Ben Affleck still reprising the role in Zack Snyder's Batman versus Superman Dawn of Justice. But Michael Keaton has been tapped to do Batman in Tim Burton's. Wait,
wasn't that movie horrible already?
Which one?
Dawn of Justice?
The Batman versus Superman.
Not only that, then we have the Robert Pattinson Batman movie coming out like this summer or like this fall or something. That. Like they're overlapping now. I don't like this.
This is like opening. This is opening too many sprinkles at a time, and then all the cupcake shops fold at the same time.
I was about to say that.
Yeah.
But Gina fucking cut me off at the pass. Potter Mike down. I was going to make the sprinkles analogy. Ron, how say you?
I'm more Batman's the better. Why not? Who cares if they're going to do Batman Beyond? There's already stories with old Batman that teaches the younger Batman. Maybe that's what we're headed to. And that's the case. Those are good storylines. But if not, then it's just very confusing. But there's already a lot of Spider-Man. So why not?
Yeah, it's weird. Like, I kind of think in a linear James Bond kind of way, which is you can switch the guy out, but you can't have three James Bonds going at the same time. That would probably bump me, but who knows?
Well, speaking of Oscar wins, Ron, you must have seen the Into the Spider-Verse a couple years ago.
So good.
Spectacular movie. And it was like a bunch of Spider-Men, and they had a lot of fun with it. It was great.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, Peter Porker. If they do something similar, it'd be great. Yeah, John Mulaney.
God, that was so great. Spider-Ham.
All right, let me give Ron a plug before we bid him adieu. Golden Arm is the movie. It's available on Apple TV, digital, and select theaters. And you can also check out the podcast, Getting Better with Ron Funches, as well. Available on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and YouTube. As well, and let's not forget Salt Lake City Wise Guys and Phoenix Stand Up Live as well. Coming up, Ron, always great to see you, my friend.
Always a pleasure. Thank you guys for having me.
And we'll take a quick break. We'll come back with the news right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. Weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gina Grad. Stuff they saw on TMZ. Joe Biden, Kamala. Meet news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
So it's official. Well, it's getting official. Caitlyn Jenner does want to represent Californians in the state capitol. The former track and field Olympic gold medalist turned reality TV star has been rumored to be mulling over a possible run if current Governor Gavin Newsom is recalled. Now,
what I do now?
She came right out and announced it. She's 71. She said, I've been a compassionate disruptor throughout my life, from representing the United States and winning a gold medal at the Olympics to helping advance the movement for equality. As Californians, we face a now or never opportunity to fundamentally fix our state before it's too late.
Hey, Max Pata, did you get that? Did I forward you that email that Mike sent me on this?
Yeah.
There's so it was comical because I was talking to August about this yesterday. And I said, well, Caitlin's a Republican. That's not going to go over well in California. He said, yeah, but transgendered. She's going to get the trans whatever. I said, are you kidding? They're going to fucking turn on her in 10 seconds. There's nobody. And I said, you know, look, this is how it works. You can't be a Republican and transgendered. You're just a Republican. And Candace Owens is a black woman, but she's not black. She's a Republican. That's how it works. And he's like, well, they know they do the math with blacks and they do the math with Hispanics or women or whatever, but they've not figured out the transgender thing. And I said, oh, they'll figure it out quick. There's not going to be any support on the left side of the aisle just because of the transgender. She's a transgender who voted for Trump. This is this is not going to work in California. You're not going to win people over just because they're down with the cause. And then the next day he sent me an email that said, oh, you're right. And it was like George Takei and everyone else just saying, denouncing Kayla. So it's not going to get any mileage out of the transgender.
You're right, because I said the same thing, remember? And you made that point, and I absolutely agree with you. I wonder if on the other side of that coin, if you put it, you know, put a mirror up to it, if people who would generally not be down with the transgender community would be like, I don't know. I kind of like the cut of her jib. She supported Trump. She believes in some of the stuff I believe. Does it work both ways or no? Or
I don't know. First off, I'm trying to figure out how big the community is because I only have Caitlyn in it. I don't know a lot of other transgenders. They're
what about,
out there.
What's her name from Orange is the New Black? God, she's getting
all right. Now we're up to two.
Yeah, who else?
That's my thing. We have this community we built, the transgender community. It's way less than 0.1%.
Absolutely.
So I don't know how many votes you can get out of the transgender community.
I imagine when they talk about the community, they're about supporters.
The allyship.
Yeah. Yes. All right. Well, you got the you got that email.
Yeah, August gave you 6 bullet points here. So number one. Jenner is a registered Republican and voted for Trump in 2016, but not in 2020, in protest against his position on transgender issues.
Too late. Dies cast.
Is there? Yeah, it's too late.
All right. Number two, the confirmation of her run sparked an instant backlash among the American public, celebrities, and even the LGBTQ plus community. Mm. Three, Star Wars actor George Takei. I think. Okay.
By the way, George, do we need to hear from fucking George Takei anymore about the evils of the Japanese American internment camp from 1943 or the
sounds
the
like
community?
Moved on.
Yeah, and also, I think it's Star Trek. August,
yeah, it is.
Star Trek.
Okay. Well, Star Wars actor George Takei, who is gay, compared her standing in the LGBTQ community to that of Candace Owens in the black community.
This is how I said to Mike, I go, Candace Owens, not black, not going to work. It's the same thing. And 10 seconds later, here comes George Takei.
Confirming.
Weighing in. Thank you, George. You're such a fine thespian from Star Trek from 1967.
Star Wars.
George Takei. Jesus fucking Christ.
He's all very right. active on Twitter.
Anyway, so good luck with the LGBT plus Q plus community, Caitlin, because it ain't going to work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Manhattan District Attorney Cyrus Vance Jr. announced that his office will stop prosecuting prostitution and unlicensed massage, according to Rolling Stone.
Live show New York!
Vance announced the new policy in court and ended up asking a judge to dismiss more than 900 cases from past years. So he's not alone in declining to prosecute prostitution cases. New York has joined cities like Baltimore, which have made similar announcements in the wake of ongoing discussions about sex work, decriminalization, and criminal justice reform. Other boroughs like Queens have also announced they will be moving to dismiss these cases too.
I've always been a fan of the consensual crimes not really being prosecuted. If that's kind of commerce, if somebody wants a hand job and someone wants to give it to them, I've never been a, you know, I've felt the same about weed, certain other drugs, you know, I'm that way. Unfortunately, I feel like with a lot of defunding of the police and the general sort of attack on incarceration, that we're just kind of doing this with many crimes now. And that just means more crime. And that's what we're seeing now in a lot of the big cities. So I'm all for the consensual stuff. But if you're going to punch some old Asian woman in the face and then get let out that night, not a fan of that.
Right.
That's not reform to me.
And I don't know who first made this comparison, you know, not a direct comparison, but let me posit this to you. I have heard in some conversation somewhere, somebody comparing legalized prostitution to a puppy mill and basically saying, like, look, it is not a good thing to decriminalize this because the women are still victims, but now their pimps won't get caught. Their pimps won't go to jail. So they're going to keep turning these girls out who would, you know, would love to be up. But now they have the underworld, you know, community and the government both sort of fostering it slash looking the other way.
Well, it's bringing back to a conversation I had with Shelby Coffey, the editor of the Los Angeles Times, a million years ago when I was his boxing coach. And we were sitting around having lunch on a Saturday after I did a private lesson. Boxing lesson with him. And something I told Drew later on in life, and Drew brings it back every once in a while. And that's why I'm sort of agnostic on this stuff. So I was saying to Shelby, so what's wrong with legalizing weed or decriminalizing drugs or prostitution or all these kind of consensual whatevers? And he just said, well, you can do that, but then that's kind of the society you're living in.
Right.
and do you want to live in that society? And I was kind of like, well, I kind of get the global argument of, yeah, I kind of don't want to live in that neighborhood per se. But, you know, when you get to all this stuff, whether it's the young girls deciding to be sex workers, somehow it's empowering now to say she's a sex worker,
which is
she's a fucking victim of molestation, and now she's fucking 19 and cuts on herself and can't get a job at the Starbucks, so she fucks businessmen and gets ripped off by her pimp.
Oh, like, I watch Law and Order.
Is that empowering to them? But my thing of whether it's the 16-year-old chick who's got the steak knife or this mill, this never-ending farm team of young women ready to go into sex work now to get their union papers to work as a sex worker, I would start looking at where do these girls come from, whether it's the one with the steak knife or the ones that carjacked the Uber Eats guy and killed him or the sex worker. Right. Let's start really breaking down the game film. Where are they coming from? What's going on? Let's talk about the family unit. Who is producing this new crop of sex workers? Yep. Because this is fairly unthinkable when you come from a decent, intact family. It's hard to create a crop of this. And, you know, we do. It's interesting. We do with these women who are like in the sex worker trade, we do with them what we do with the homeless. Like, hey, these are 20-year-old women who are now empowered and want to take in charge. That may be less than 1% of them. The rest of them are victims.
Right.
And it's like the homeless person, it's not a junkie. It's not someone with mental disorders. This is the mother of three who lost her job. That's less than 1%. I don't know why you want to take this vast minority and turn them into some sort of hometown hero for deciding to sleep on the fucking sidewalk or yank a guy off for $50. There's a problem here.
Right.
The homeless problem, sex workers, there's a root cause. We should be trying to get to the root.
I agree with you. I mean, I know women who are in the adult film business, and the ones I've met are...
Well, that's a healthy outlet of a creative expression. But keep moving, Gina. Not the greatest example.
They're, you know, I know I've met a couple girls, and they're cool, and they seem like, you know, nice, salty, they're girls and whatever, and they may be the exception. But you know what comes to mind? Again, not apples and oranges, not even close. But if you had the cool teacher in a class, like in, say, middle school, who was just like, I don't get anyone in trouble. You know, I'm cool. I'm one of you. And lets the kid in the class get picked on. Then that kid's thinking, like, why isn't anyone helping me? Why isn't anyone coming to my aid? Oh, because you're the cool teacher. I'm sorry. So I'm just supposed to sit here and get tortured for 45 minutes. So, like, do we just want to be the cool teacher and we're not actually trying to protect anybody?
Well, there's a couple things working here. One is we've decided that we don't like how much incarceration we see in this country or law enforcement interactions, especially with the black community and so on and so forth. It's a lot of this, a lot of it is an extension of that thing I've always sort of told you about, which is you're fat, you don't like what the scale says. You don't want to do what Ron Funches did, which is start exercising and stop drinking soda. So you go, well, just adjust the scale. Just what's it say? It says I'm 255. Well, let me turn it down to 180.
Problem solved.
Yeah, or like kids aren't passing the math test. Well, let's change the math test. Maybe if we just went and lowered that, you know, this weird, it's a kind of a post fix. It's like we have a problem with termites in our house. Well, don't get a termite inspection. Looks like, okay. Well,
no smog check here.
That'll clean it up. I mean, you're not going to get a bad inspection notice from a termite inspector, but this is really a weird way to address problems. But again, it's like homeless, prostitution, you know, failing inner city schools or whatever, going and retroactively going, well, we have prison overcrowding. Well, stop putting people in prison.
Right.
Stops prison overcrowding, but now you just have a lot of criminals running around.
Right.
And that's probably not what you want for society. And when, you know, it's like a lot of these cities now, in the last year have had huge spikes in murders because the cops have pulled back because we didn't want the cops getting involved. So the cops are like, fine, you don't want me to get involved, we won't get involved. And the thing about criminals, I would argue criminals are possibly the most and least pragmatic people on the planet.
How least?
Least in that
they plan ahead super well.
They do a lot of shit like they're been on parole twice and they're going to go to the corner, but they think it'd be a good idea to take their gun with them. And then the cop pulls them over and now there's three strikes.
Got
and
it.
Now they go. So it's kind of a, or they steal a bag of Funyuns or Tipperillos from the corner store. Now it's like for
life
that,
sentence.
You know, but in terms of practicality, you know, like we talk about with the cartels at the border, they'll give whatever we take them. They'll take whatever we give them, I should say, which is we give them this, they'll take that. You know, if you go, we're going to pull back on policing in the crime-ridden inner cities. They go, okay, well, more killing, more for us. Like, that's just how it works. So we can't solve the problem by decriminalizing everything and not, you know, telling the police to step back. There's a version of this.
Right. And like Dr. Drew said, and I think it's the same for sex workers. He's like, do homeless people belong in prison? No, that's not where you go. And that's exactly how I think how people who want to protect sex workers feel like they don't belong in prison. But I really think that if we pull back the layer, like you said, they're not like, oh, this is a great idea. I feel so empowered. Somebody is turning them out and they need to be protected.
Yeah, and you want to talk about drug abuse.
Right.
That's probably a pretty high ratio of those gals are supporting drug habits, so I don't know.
We'll see.
Don't know what the answer is.
DMX, his funeral procession was pretty, it was a lot of pomp, a lot of circumstance.
What?
Yeah, we have a video here. A procession of the Rough Riders rap group, hundreds of motorcyclists, and a monster truck bearing a red coffin, reportedly carrying DMX's body. They converged at the rapper's memorial at Barclays Center in Brooklyn on Saturday. The monster truck, coming up here on the screen, was emblazed with the logo.
They got President Camacho on a trike. Throwing revs.
That's right. Long live DMX, it said, and began their procession in Yonkers, where he grew up. The memorial ride was called the Rough Riders 2, the Rescue Ride for Life. It was for Earl Simmons, DMX. He died on the 9th at White Plains Hospital, suffered a heart attack, apparent drug overdose. He was 50, but I pulled another clip because YouTube has like the whole 2-hour service and there's lots happening. But remember not too long ago, obviously right after he died, you mentioned like the little kids on TV.
Yes, and his video.
Right. So at least a few of his kids spoke. I think he has 6. And his daughter.
Wait a minute. Yeah. I think he has like 15 or something.
6 confirmed on Google.
Six confirmed. There may be another 9 or so floating around out there. I remember hearing a fairly astronomical.
You might be right. I mean, I Googled it, and that's the first number that came up. But I could be, you know, that could not be telling the whole story.
I have no idea. I just remember thinking, that's a lot of kids.
Yeah, it says DMX was a father of 15 children. Of 15 children from 9 different women.
Oh, maybe one of them was 6 of them. But there was a little girl, one of his children, who got up and did like a 3-minute sort of rap. Mm-hmm. So you can call the out, but this is one of the kids.
I think she was at Ozzie's funeral too.
Okay.
I learned so much from him, so I dedicate this song to him. Ayo, I'm growing, I'm learning to hold my head up. Ayo, I'm growing, I'm learning to hold my head up. Ayo, I'm growing, I'm learning. Hold my head up. My daddy's still holding my hand, so I gotta stand up. Yo, I'm growing. I'm learning to hold my head up. Yo, I'm growing. I'm learning to hold my head up. Yo, I'm growing. I'm learning to hold my head up.
Better than the bat dance.
Still holding my hand, so I gotta get up. And yo, I learned so much from my father. He taught me life is my story. I'm the author. He taught me to be strong, but it's okay to be afraid. Cause sometimes it'll show you how to be brave. I know how to get up whenever I fall. I never give up. I give it my all. Cause I know I'm big even though I look small. Looking at my daddy's picture on the wall. I know he want me to be the best I can be. Nobody else, I gotta be me. My brothers and sisters, we all stand together. Throw up the X, daddy forever.
What are you talking about?
I learn how to understand the good and the bad. I look in the all mirror right. sometimes.
Oh, we got another 2 minutes.
Yeah. I want that kid working my funeral.
Yeah.
If my dad or mom kick off, I'd like to get her there. Mm-hmm. Like just, you know, Taylor. It's always.
Bespoke.
You know what's always weird? And I was thinking about because I was at Ozzie's funeral yesterday. The person that talks the most is the person that knows him the least. It's the priest, you know?
Yes.
And they go, like, they get up there and they go, I didn't have a chance to meet with Ozzie personally, but hearing what some of you have said about him, it makes me.
Sounds like a special guy.
And it's like, then he does 20 minutes, yeah. but he's the only person in the tent that hasn't Madam. Hung.
Yeah. yeah. There's a Family Guy, no, American Dad, where I think it's the preacher is played by Martin Mull, and he's doing a funeral, and he's saying, you know, this gentleman was a wonderful guy. You know, he had the most flaxen blonde hair and piercing blue eyes, a you know, man of 6'2", and you look down, he's reading his driver's license.
right. That's right. All right, let's do one more, Gina
All right.
Grant.
Well, I have one that I have been meaning to get to after August showed off his sweet new detail job on his car. As you said, it's just good business to have a flat black roof in California.
Yeah, man, you need that heat. It needs to penetrate the sheet
right.
metal of the roof
that's
and
right.
really just cook the whole car through conduction.
Exactly.
Or convection.
Convection. But for the rest of us, scientists at Purdue University have created the whitest paint in the world, and they think it could eliminate the need for air conditioning. That, and we're looking at the square of the whitest white.
Ed Sheeran.
Paint is so white that it reflects more than
It is so crazy, the colors. You know, Phil is the blackest dog on the planet. When Phil comes out in the morning and lays down in the backyard and the sun hits him, he just lays there. You go put your hand on his fur, it's almost burns your hand. Like he conducts the black
and
so
he's
much
fine.
Fucking. He just literally goes out to lay down and warm up Tucker Carlson and clears his schnoz, and then he goes back in. But you can feel it.
Right. It hurts almost.
Right.
This is supposed to reflect more than 98% of the sunlight that hits it, which means it also reflects heat. Scientists say painting the roof of apartment buildings or the roof of a house could eliminate the need for running the AC all day. On top of that, they think painting a rocky surface of the earth where no one lives could help prevent global warming. They think the paint will be available to buy in 2 years.
AOC has already called it racist paint.
Shit. Because this could really help.
This could help, but not. She's not going to hire the Klan to help. That's what this is. Yeah. Also, it is nuts. We figured out painting the roofs of these flat roof buildings, this like reflective paint helps a lot. But in the last 10 minutes, before that, roofs were tar paper and tar.
Right. Hot black tar.
Black-ass tar. Right. And then dark charcoal tar paper is like charcoal colored. Right. The tar is black. And that was on every flat roof in the San Fernando Valley. And of course, every warehouse was just steaming hot inside. This notion that no one thought, well, let's paint it white or let's color this or let's make the tar paper white.
Okay, Picasso, or can we just put the tar down?
Yeah, no one ever sees it.
Yeah.
And it would reflect so much heat. And it's so crazy that, and there's also, we talked about the radiant barrier, basically the tinfoil. If you go to the Costco or the big box place and you look up at the ceiling, you see that silver, that's radiant barrier. Like even when the heat comes through, it bounces it back.
Oh, so
huge difference. If anybody, and you don't have to have a warehouse, you can have a house. So
with tinfoil all over it.
Well, what you do is you go up to the attic, and when you go up to the attic, you'll see the rafters, the roof rafters, and you staple on the radiant barrier to the inside of the roof rafters, and the radiant barrier does a huge job. Max Pat, are you a flat roofer?
Yeah.
Yeah, I figured. Yeah. You got a fridge with a drawer. You got the
Actually, my roof has a pretty good pitch on it. I've been up there, and it's actually kind of scary.
Have you been in the attic?
Yeah, I've been in the attic as well.
Get that radiant barrier going, man.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll look into that. And then my fridge is the double, like the French door style.
Ooh, la la. Mm.
Wait, Brian, what did we figure out with fridges?
He likes the
French
freezer
doors
on the bottom.
For winners.
No, but the baller move is freezer on the bottom, of course, mm-hmm. with the French doors. Mm-hmm. Not so great is that. Well,
wait, freezer on the bottom. Wait a minute.
Yeah. Freezer on the bottom.
Yeah, typically
is side by side. Mm-hmm. The freezer on the side and the fridge on the side. Mm-hmm. And then if you're slumming it, you got the freezer on top.
Yeah, the white fridge.
But that's bad.
Does this help? I have a second fridge in the shed.
Mm. Ooh, a shed.
Yeah. Mm. All right.
Yeah, we had the freezer. God, when I was a kid, it seemed like we had the freezer up top with this extra plastic door that was over.
Where the ice went. The ice cubes.
Right, and you just pound. You have to take a pick and pound at it.
I can't picture that.
The ice cubes go in the little cubby.
Yeah, there's a little doghouse on the top. Ugh.
Wait, inside or out on
the freezer?
Oh, yeah, okay. I thought you meant there was an extra door like...
And you guys missed the complete, like, Venetian blind, weird aluminum ice tray thing that we talked about before.
We never heard of that until a couple weeks ago.
Oh, the worst. First off, it would frost over, and you'd grab the aluminum handle, and it would take your skin off when you try to pull it off, like putting your tongue on a flagpole.
That seems like when you hit a baseball at a batting cage, and it hurts because of the metal.
Yes, that feeling. And then you would have to just... Bang and bang. It was all this weird aluminum ice tray. It's always interesting to me that there was one version of this ice tray and it lasted for 41 years. Mm-hmm. And then someone went, what the fuck are we doing? This thing doesn't work. This is the worst. The one I had in North Hollywood in the late 70s was the exact same one that Lucille Ball had in the 50s.
In the ice chest.
That's right. All right, let's bring it home.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
I got to get my dick in some pussy or some asshole or in a mouth or something like now.
Right, sure. Gina
Grad. That was the news with Gina Grad.
Who's who we got tomorrow there, Max Zapata, by the way? Didn't put it on the screen. Wait, what did Mike August say? Did he call it Star Wars?
Star Wars, yeah.
It's so funny. I have this autocorrect with Mike that I don't have time to go back and circle back and tell him all the stuff he gets wrong when he's shooting me an email. So my brain, it's like I know George Takei's from Star Trek and not in Star Wars. So I just keep moving.
And you don't want to derail him when you're still trying to get to the point that you're trying to make.
Right. So but I realize now I don't even hear it.
Right.
I have like an autocorrect for him. All right, let me tell you about Air Medcare Network. That's right. Health insurance doesn't always cover the full cost of an emergency medical flight. Even with comprehensive coverage, you could get hit with a substantial copay and deductible. Plan ahead. In emergency, Air Medcare Network's highly trained crews provide air medical transport to the nearest, most appropriate trauma center. With Air Medcare Network membership, you pay no out-of-pocket expenses for your flight, and an AMCN membership covers your entire household for as little as $85 a year. That's everyone for $85 a year. Peace of mind. Secure your financial peace of mind. As a listener, you can get up to a $50 e-gift card with a new membership. So visit airmedcarenetwork.com/Adam. Use the offer code Adam and get that gift card at aircarenetwork.com. Oh, sorry, airmedcarenetwork.com. That's what I want to say. All right, Appleton, Wisconsin Skyline Comedy Club coming up May 7th and 8th. Doing stand-up there. We're also doing live pod there as well. We're also going to be in Los Angeles jamming the van. Brian's walking over.
Yeah.
That'll be May 22nd. We'll do a live pod there. A lot of fun. And also Golden, Colorado, Buffalo Rose, June 18th and 19th. And Dawson doing a stand-up opening for Brad Williams, Bray Improv, this Friday and Saturday, late show. So go out and support awesome Dawson over there. And until next time, Sam Carolla for Ron Funches and Gina Gradenball, Ryan Sayer. Mahalo.
I'm going to vanquish you and then have sex with your fiance in front of your corpse because that's what she wanted. And I'm just trying to give her what she needs.